Hello, I'm Laura Mills, Education and Outreach Coordinator for CBSC. This presentation will share updates made to the 2022 edition of the California Green Building Standards Code, Part 11 of Title 24, also known as CALGreen. During the intervening code adoption cycle, the Commission approved and adopted new electric vehicle charging regulations that go into effect on July 1st of 2024. Because the regulations were adopted during an intervening cycle, they are known as supplements to the 2022 edition of Title 24. The 2022 edition of Title 24 has been in effect since January 1st of 2023. Errata, which are cleanups and non-regulatory corrections, were made available in December for Parts 2, 2.5, 5, 6, 9, and 11, and they took effect on the same date, January 1st of 2023. The supplements for Parts 1, 2, 2.5, 3, 4, 5, 9, 10, and 11 were published January 1st, 2024, and will become effective on July 1st of 2024. If you're not familiar with the parts of Title 24, you can see a list with their names on the Codes tab of our website. First, let's look at the updated electric vehicle charging regulations. As mentioned earlier, very few state agencies have authority within CalGreen, just BSC, DSA, HCD, and OSHPOD. In addition to those, the California Energy Commission has authority in CalGreen for energy-related provisions in Appendix Chapters A4.2 and A5.2. The Building Standards Commission proposes regulations for state universities and colleges, state-owned buildings, and all other non-residential buildings not under the authority of the other agencies previously noted. And the banner for these adoptions is BSC CG for CalGreen. In the 2022 CalGreen supplements, BSC CalGreen co-adopted and slightly amended some existing definitions relative to electric vehicle charging, EV spaces, and types of chargers and receptacles. Next, alternative methods for providing more EV charging in the state were adopted. The first alternative compliance method is to use different types of EV-capable spaces. This method is spelled out in Section 5.106.5.3.2 and demonstrated in Associated Table 5.106.5.3.1. BSC developed a new code section, 5.106.5.3.2.1, for direct current fast chargers to be substituted on a 1-to-5 ratio for both EV-capable spaces, which was already allowed in existing code, or independently, electric vehicle charging stations, known as EVCS, using Level 2 chargers. BSC also developed new Section 5.106.5.3.2.2 that allows for two low power level 2 receptacles to be substituted for one EV capable space. A footnote to Table 5.106.5.3.1 was added requiring at least one level 2 electric vehicle supply equipment, which is the equipment that permits charging of a vehicle. The second EV compliance option is to use the new power allocation method and associated table. The new code section and table are solely based on power in kilovolt amps, KVA. This option is meant to be used in lieu of and independently of the EV capable charging requirements in Section 5.106.5.3.1 and its table just described. This alternative was crafted using the required power allocation in amps from the number of required EV-capable spaces from Table 5.106.5.3.1. So the two tables are meant to be equals, and using either table will achieve the same amount of power allotment per site. CBSC's Supplement Guide to the 2022 CALGreen provides detailed explanation of these changes and suggests compliance methods along with recommendations and use cases. This guide is free to download from our CALGreen webpage. In response to AB 684 of 2019, BSC CG developed EV charging regulations for additions and alterations to existing buildings or parking facilities. There are now three triggers that will require EV charging installation. 1. When the scope of construction work includes an increase in power supply to an electric service panel as part of a parking facility addition or alteration. 2. When installing a new photovoltaic system within or covering an existing parking lot, or 3, as per section 301.3, when the addition or alteration to a structure is either an additional 1,000 square feet with an electrical panel upgrade, or separately, a tenant improvement project with a permit valuation of more than $200,000, and includes an increase in power supply to an electric service panel. If it does not meet one of these three criteria, the project would be exempt from this code requirement. There are also four exceptions in the new code for additions and alterations. First, on a case-by-case basis, a determination by the local enforcing agency of the following. There is no local utility power supply. The local utility is unable to supply adequate power. An EV charging installation will have an adverse impact on the cost of a project, or where it is demonstrated as impracticable. For example, the installation would require trenching across a major roadway to access the parking facility. Another exception is for remote parking facilities that do not have access to a building service panel, or if a parking area is having lighting upgrades, but trenching is not part of the scope of work. And finally, if the work is to make emergency repairs, including such events as a water line break in a parking facility, a natural disaster, and similar situations. If the project meets one of the three criteria that requires compliance and does not have an exception, then there are two conditions. The project is an existing building or parking area without previously installed EV-capable infrastructure, or the project is an existing building or parking area with previously installed EV-capable infrastructure. For both of these conditions, compliance can be achieved by using either option 1, the EV-capable section, or independently by using option 2, the power allocation method. The EV-capable compliance method, option 1, uses the number of actual parking spaces and assigns the required number of EV-capable spaces using a dedicated 208-240-volt 40 amps branch circuit for each EV-capable space. This method requires that 5% of the total actual parking spaces have installed chargers using various charging types. The power allocation method, option 2, takes the number of actual parking spaces and assigns the required needed power based on 208-240-volt 40 amps converted into kVA, or 1,000-volt amps. This method allows for the use of any combination of EV-capable spaces, low power level 2 chargers, level 2 chargers, and direct current fast chargers, also known as DCFC. For a project with previously installed infrastructure, If the area being added or altered exceeds the existing EV-capable capacity and allocated power, additional EV charging should be provided as needed. Now, let's look at some examples of how to comply with the new requirements. This slide shows a portion of the EV-capable spaces compliance method table. For a project having between 101 to 150 actual parking spaces, it is required that 25 be allocated as EV-capable parking spaces, with 6 of those needing electric vehicle supply equipment. Let me take a moment to define the different terms we're going to use on the next few slides. EV-capable spaces are spaces that have the infrastructure to install future chargers. EVCS is an EV charging station and where the EV supply equipment resides. You can charge an electric vehicle there. EVSE is electric vehicle supply equipment, which is the infrastructure and equipment in an EVCS that charges a vehicle. So EVSE and EVCS go together. Footnote 2 in this table clarifies that the number of required EVSEs, shown in column 3, counts toward the EV-capable spaces shown in column 2. So in this example, you would subtract the 6 required installed chargers from the 25 EV-capable spaces and have 19 remaining required EV-capable spaces. Code compliance can be achieved using various scenarios. Scenario 1. Install 19 EV-capable spaces for future build-out and 6 usable charging stations for a total of 25. This is the code minimum. Scenario 2. Using Section 5.106.5.3.2.2, which allows substitution of 2 low power level 2 charging receptacles for 1 EV-capable space, to equal the 19 capable spaces, we can install 20 low power level 2 receptacles, which equates to 10 EV-capable spaces, leaving 9 EV-capable spaces available to be built out in the future. To comply with the required 6 EV charging stations shown in column 3 of the table, we could simply install 6 level 2 EVSE. The results would be 20 low power level 2 receptacles and 9 EV-capable spaces for column 2, plus 6 chargers for column 3. Using this scenario would be suitable for office buildings with long dwell times. In scenario 3, we'll use section 5.106.5.3.2.1, which allows for 1 direct current fast charger, or DCFC, to replace either EV-capable spaces or, independently, EV charging stations with level 2 EVSE on a 1-to-5 ratio. To comply with this method, install 3 DCFCs, which equates to 15 EV-capable spaces, and 4 EV-capable spaces for future build-out. To comply with the required 6 EV charging stations per column 3, install 1 DCFC, which equates to 5 level 2 EVCS, leaving 1 EVCS, which must have level 2 supply equipment, per footnote 3. The level 2 charging station is good to have for those who want to charge an older EV. The results would be 3 DCFCs and 4 EV-capable spaces for column 2, and 1 DCFC plus 1 level 2 charger for column 3 of the table. Using this scenario is suitable for retail occupancies with short dwell times. The second EV compliance pathway is to use the power allocation method, which takes the number of actual parking spaces and assigns the required needed power based on 208 240 volt 40 amps converted into KVA or 1000 volt amps. This method allows for the use of any combination of EV capable spaces, low power level 2 chargers, level 2 chargers, and direct current fast chargers. This table sample is for a project with between 101 and 150 actual parking spaces. So the total power needed for a site within this range is 165 kVA. In order to comply with this requirement, you will need to convert kVA to kilowatts, which is the rating system for selecting chargers. There is a standard formula for this. In this example, 165 kVA is equivalent to 132 kW actual power. So, to meet the requirement, provide two DCFCs rated at 60 kW, which will equal 120 kW, plus two level 2 EVSE rated at 6 kW for an actual power of 12 kW. 120 plus 12 equals 132, which meets the requirement. So those were a few examples of how to apply the updated EV charging regulations. Another code change was for MHDV. In coordination with the California Air Resources Board, a subject matter expert agency, BSC expanded the requirements for installation of future EVSE for medium-duty and heavy-duty vehicle parking spaces to include manufacturing facilities and office building occupancy types, when applicable, in addition to the occupancies that were already required, grocery, retail, and warehouses. And finally, there were updates to the voluntary tiers that correspond with the mandatory updates. The tiers in CalGreen are provided for local jurisdictions to adopt and make mandatory, or for voluntary use by designers and builders. In the regulations that will be effective on July 1st, Tier 1 and Tier 2 EV provisions were updated to align with the allowed DCFC 1:5 ratio for both EV-capable and electric vehicle charging stations. The new power allocation method alternative compliance pathway was also added to the tiers. The existing percentages of spaces were not changed, though, so the new regulations are only the new methods of compliance and not an increase in those percentages. Finally, the table footnote was added to require the installation of at least one Level 2 EVSE. And that concludes this section on the new EV charging regulations. If you want to learn more, visit CBSC's resources webpage, where we have shared lots of guides and videos. The items of most interest to viewers of this video will probably be the CalGreen guide and supplement guide that are also posted on our CalGreen webpage. These guides provide the text of the regulations and then detailed information about the intent and implementation of the codes and how to review plans and enforce them. As always, please contact CBSC with any questions. Here's our contact information and website address. If you're interested in participating in the code development process, receiving announcements about code effective dates, or seeing our periodical newsletter, among other announcements, you can go to the Contact Us page to sign up for our mailing list.